Welcome back to the mock draft here on the channel. This is a continuation of our mock draft series. Moving in to the end of week four here, we are recording this Monday night before the Monday night matchup between the Las Vegas Raiders and Los Angeles Chargers. That's a little bit of the background that you need to know. And in today's video, we are going to be coming at you with the entire first round. Make sure to hit that like button. Let's try and get 100 likes on today's video. That would mean a lot to us here at Utility Sports. And if you guys are new, make sure to hit that subscribe button. We have an awesome jersey giveaway coming up very soon here on the channel. We would love for you to be a part of it. And the best way to do so is hit that subscribe button, comment on today's video, and also leave a like so you can remember to come back next week and the future weeks as well as we give a little bit more information on that jersey giveaway. Now, Austin, looking here, we at pick one, we have your Jacksonville Jaguars. They moved to 0-4, had a slim, narrow defeat on Thursday Night Football this past week against the Cincinnati Bengals. And then Urban Meyer was caught out in public with a woman that was not his wife. Tough week for Jacksonville, moving to 0-4, and then, of course, some drama around that franchise. We're not going to talk too much about that in today's video. We're going to focus more on how they can right the wrong long-term. Who is the selection here for them at pick one if they are at this spot come draft night?
Trent Baalke has to make the right pick here. It's going to have to come on the defense because the defense is still atrocious. The offense really is, it's not much better, but they do have to address the defensive side of the ball. Kayvon Thibodeau is going to be the pick. I think he is the highest upside player potentially in this class. I think, you know, the other defensive players like Kyle Hamilton and Derek Stingley would be awesome additions to this defense. You really can't go wrong with those top three players to add to your defense. However, Kayvon Thibodeau has that high upside. He has that athleticism. He's good against the run, and he has potential to be a very, very good pass rusher in this league. I think this is a wonderful fit for Jacksonville, and they have to really restore that defense that they had just a couple of years ago in 2017. The defense is a complete shell of itself.
Right, Kayvon Thibodeau could be a massive step in the right direction for reclaiming that name Saxonville there in Duval County. I think it would be huge for Jacksonville to land a player of his caliber, especially on that defensive front. Put him across from Josh Allen. I like Kalavon Chase on as a situational pass rusher as well. You have a nice combination of guys who can get after it, get to the quarterback, hopefully long term, with a lot of athleticism and youth on the field. I think this is a dream scenario for the Jaguars if they're at one to grab a guy like Kayvon Thibodeau. Moving into pick two, we have the Detroit Lions, another team that is winless yet at this point. They have a week five matchup here against the Minnesota Vikings at US Bank Stadium. And now, looking at this Lions team, it just doesn't look like it's going to get much easier for them. They've had some narrow defeats. They played, I think, better than we had expected, and they're still 0-4 at this point. It's just looking like a tough scenario for them. How does Detroit go about getting better long-term? Is it a quarterback here at pick two?
You have to definitely think about the quarterback position, especially if they end the season this bad in terms of win-loss record. I just don't see Jared Goff surviving, whether it's his fault or not. A lot of times the quarterback is the scapegoat for these top teams picking here. So I'm actually going to have the most dynamic prospect in the class in terms of overall athleticism and just his overall flash. Malik Willis is going to be the pick. He is the number one player in college football with 20-plus yard runs, and he's a quarterback. That's really, really incredible. Super dynamic with his legs. He has nice touch on his deep ball, and he's got a really, really quick release. He's almost the entire total package of what you're looking for in a quarterback. And with that dynamism, you add him with DeAndre Swift, TJ Hockenson, that offense is looking a lot better. Their offensive line is already starting to get to where it needs to be, but you add Malik Willis to this team and they're going to become dangerous.
I think Malik Willis is still someone who nationally is being a little bit overlooked, especially by mainstream media and also the fans. I think he's someone who's not as well known as he should be. We're mocking him second overall. He continues to ascend our board, going higher and higher each and every mock, and he's the real deal. They're out of Liberty. I know he's playing at a small school against, you know, maybe not the absolute best competition week in, week out, but it's not a flash in the pan. Everything that he shows on tape is going to translate well to the NFL, and that dynamism that you mentioned, Austin, will be phenomenal for the Detroit Lions to build their offense around. Think about the combination of Malik Willis, DeAndre Swift, Penei Sewell. That should get Detroit Lions fans really excited for the long-term future of that organization. Moving into pick three, we have the New York Jets, who had a surprising upset win over the Tennessee Titans. Zach Wilson looked absolutely phenomenal in overtime, made a few beautiful throws that really set them up to win that football game, Austin, especially with that Randy Bullock missed field goal to end it. Jets here at three, however, still, of course, haven't had the best season yet to this point. What could they really do to kind of fix some of the flaws in this roster?
They have to address the secondary. You need somebody opposite of Bryce Hall, and Derek Stingley is going to provide that for this team. Reason being, he's an elite man coverage guy, very good in zone as well, very good athlete on top of that, actually an elite athlete. So he's once again one of those can't miss guys at the top of the draft. New York would do really, really well for themselves if they're able to land him at pick number three. Just considering that this guy, this could have a little bit of shades of Darrelle Revis. If Jets fans really can think back to those good old days, those glory days, they just haven't had a defensive player like that. Derek Stingley can be that guy moving forward.
That gets me really excited as a New York Jets fan myself, hearing any comparison to Darrelle Revis. Derek Stingley is a phenomenal athlete. Very fluid hips and really good in coverage, which are all the things you're looking for a cornerback prospect. Very rare you see a cornerback go in the top three of the NFL draft, Austin. And at pick one, you had actually name dropped Stingley as well there. Is there a potential chance that Stingley is the first overall pick in this year's draft?
I think there's a chance, but you know, it always holds you back because you get a little worried. Sometimes corners don't always transition the best to the NFL. It's a very, very tough position to play. And, you know, sometimes you're a little skeptical of it. However, I think Derek Stingley has a decent shot of doing so. As long as a quarterback needy team doesn't end up at number one, I think there is a chance.
Right. That'll be a fun storyline to monitor. Of course, that quarterback position always throws a wrench into things. And edge position as well. There's a lot of value there at that point. Kayvon Thibodeau went one in this mock. We'll see exactly how it plays out come draft night. Make sure you guys are subscribed to keep up with this series to see how the draft really evolves over the coming months going up into the NFL draft itself. Moving into pick four now, we have the Philadelphia Eagles on the clock. This pick comes from the Miami Dolphins in the trades that they made last offseason leading up to last year's draft. And I think right now the writing's on the wall, Austin, with who they need to look at with this spot. He's one of the best players in this class, arguably the best defensive player in this class, and very, very dynamic in the back half of a defense. Who is this player for Philadelphia?
This is going to be Kyle Hamilton. I think Kyle Hamilton offers so much versatility. You can put him in the box, you can have him be the high safety. There's a lot to love about his game. He can cover a deep third. There is so much to love about the entire package of him, and Philadelphia is going to be looking to rebuild that secondary. So getting a franchise level safety who will be, you know, probably top five for sure at his position for many years to come is no joke. And getting him with that 6'4 frame and how athletic he is for his size, it's absolutely incredible. Great value here at number four.
Right, Eagles fans, you have three picks in this year's draft. So after you watch this mock draft here to completion, go on our channel, check out the Kyle Hamilton highlight reel we have from him from last year. He was phenomenal last year for the Fighting Irish, and he's even better this year, making plays all over the football field. This is an A-plus level pick for Philadelphia. Pick number five, we have the Atlanta Falcons here, a team that just can't get out of their own way. Blew another late lead, ended up losing this past week in week four. They face the Jets in London in week five. Now that'll be a fun matchup to watch. Where does Atlanta really look to go from here? Of course, quarterback could be a question mark long-term with Matt Ryan aging. The offensive line, I think, could be a question mark. And that defense, I mean, we've been saying it for years that they need a lot of help on defense yet. Where could Atlanta look to go at five?
Yeah, there's a lot of different directions that they need to go and need to consider. Especially on defense, they've needed edge rusher for quite some time. But they're actually going to prioritize the quarterback position. Matt Corral is going to be my pick. He's been very, very impressive. A guy that was very under the radar, especially going into this season. He still hasn't thrown a pick yet. They played Alabama this past week, and they were humbled a little bit. But I mean, Matt Corral didn't look brutal by any stretch of the imagination. He held his own. The entire Ole Miss team seemed to be just a little rattled by how talented Alabama's defense was. However, Matt Corral didn't make the huge, huge mistakes, and he didn't really let it, compile on him and let Alabama's defense really frustrate him. So they were just overmatched. Matt Corral still is a very, very good prospect.
In this mock draft, we see the Falcons transitioning from one franchise quarterback named Matt to another one here with Matt Corral coming into the ATL. I love what he brings to the table. I think he could be a very nice young quarterback for that organization long term. Looking pick six now, we have the Houston Texans, a team started out the year really well with a big time win over the Jacksonville Jaguars, and then have really cooled off since, got blown out of the water by the Buffalo Bills 40-0. And it looks like it's going to be a long year for that Houston Texans team, especially with the quarterback play without Deshaun Watson. There's a lot of rumors around him, where he's going to end up and where he's going to play his football next season at some point. My assumption is he won't play at all this year. Austin, do the Texans have to look quarterback based off how the given situation is playing out, or is it just best player available at this point for Houston?
They definitely consider the best player available route, but once again, the quarterback position is going to remain key here. Davis Mills is not the franchise guy. I think we knew that when they drafted him. Yes, it is early to technically give up on him, but I don't think he is going to be the guy moving forward. This is going to be a tough year for him as a whole, just considering some of the weapons that they have, some of the offensive line struggles that they've had. They are going quarterback, and as a guy that a lot of people considered number one, the consensus number one pick before the year started, Spencer Rattler. He's had some ups and downs. Oklahoma has struggled in some of the games, and he's made some key mistakes. However, his arm talent is undeniable, and he's pretty athletic as well. He's got the entire package, but he has very, very questionable decision-making at times. But if he can kind of clean that up, this guy is dangerous.
Right. I think this is a case of don't let solid get in the way of potentially great. And that's what Spencer Rattler could be. If everything comes together for him, the physical tools he has, the mobility, the kind of combination that he presents as a quarterback could be potentially great. Now, there's still a lot of progression that we have to see from him as a passer and as a quarterback in general. But possibly moving Deshaun Watson, bringing in a few first round picks, could really expedite this rebuild here for the Houston Texans. I think Spencer Rattler would be a nice place for this organization to get started, specifically at that quarterback position. Pick seven, we have the New England Patriots here. Tough loss on Sunday Night Football in the return of Tom Brady, but they looked pretty solid as a whole that game. Really played close with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and I think that this is a team, right now they're playing without Stephon Gilmore. They have a lot of talent, especially on that defense. At pick seven, do they need to look on the offensive end, find an elite wide receiver weapon for Mac Jones, or how do they go about really trying to improve this roster? I know that's not something Bill Belichick and company really do a lot there.
I think it's critical for this pick to be a playmaker, whether that's on offense or defense. But I think that it's actually an interesting pick moving in here, because historically speaking, Bill Belichick wouldn't take a receiver at this spot. We really haven't seen them this high ever under Bill Belichick. I'm having them go wide receiver, but not the one you might think. Drake London has ascended as the wide receiver one as it currently stands. This guy has 48 catches already this season, which is absolutely insane. He's accumulated a ton of yards. He's been the go-to guy for USC. Big catch radius, and he is the true proven commodity of this wide receiver class so far. Hopefully he can run well at the combine, but that 6'5 frame, and he is an absolute volume machine. New England Patriots could find themselves an absolute stud at seven.
I love this for New England. Drake London is someone who's going to continue to climb boards. I think you're ahead of him, ahead of others here on him. A lot of people, we're going to be seeing him closer down to the 25 mark in a lot of other mock drafts. I think if our viewers are looking other places, you're ahead on Drake London. He's been phenomenal all season long. They have to go look at his numbers this year, because he has been an absolute beast for the Trojans there at USC. And I think he's going to be someone who really supplants himself as a top 10 pick in this year's draft and the wide receiver one, like you had mentioned. Pick eight. Now we have the Indianapolis Colts here on the clock. Now, this pick could possibly go to the Philadelphia Eagles. So, Austin, are you mocking this for Philadelphia, or are you mocking this for Indianapolis here?
I am going to be mocking this for the Philadelphia Eagles. I think it's very possible that they do get this pick. And now with this pick, this is where it's going to be very, very key. They are getting an absolute steal here. Evan Neal. This offense and defense are getting huge boosts by their first two picks. And the crazy thing now is, they have pick number nine, Evan Neal, former right tackle, moved to left tackle, great, great athlete, can be very, very effective in the pass game at the next level. This guy is an exciting prospect.
That's a big time pull here for Philadelphia. I love what they've been able to grab already with Evan Neal and Kyle Hamilton. Bring us into pick nine. How do they continue to build off of this already stellar draft?
Once again, we're going Kaiir Elam. We are going to the secondary of this defense. And wow, what a draft pull that they've had so far. Kyir Elam's going to be a really good man corner for them. And you also have Kyle Hamilton at the very back end of that defense. They're already looking very, very improved. Their front seven really hasn't been an issue, especially their defensive line has always been strong. Sometimes they've had issues in that secondary, but man, getting Kyir Elam and Kyle Hamilton, really impressive.
Right. I think right now at this point, the Eagles are relying too much on Darius Slay, who's getting up there in age. They need to move to a younger collection of talented players in that secondary while also pulling in the top offensive tackle in this year's class. It's an exciting and very, very strong pull here in the draft with their three picks in the first round. I think that it could be really a game-changing type scenario there for the Philadelphia Eagles. Jalen Hurts has given that city some excitement. Even if they've been losing games, he's looked pretty good. And now you bring in some really key building blocks for that organization. Really, really good draft for them at this point. At 10, we have the New York Giants here on the clock. And at this point, Austin, is there any key positions that stick out to you as points of emphasis for the New York Giants?
For me, I think that the New York Giants really need to look at that offensive line, because especially in the center and guard play, you have Will Hernandez should be a mainstay at that guard spot potentially. But a player that could be interesting, Tyler Linderbaum, does not get a lot of recognition just because he is a center. He plays at Iowa. You know, sometimes people think that's just boring, but Tyler Linderbaum is going to offer some versatility at center. He can play guard, but preferably at the next level, he will play center. And the New York Giants are really building a nice offensive line, collectively speaking. I love this pick for them. I love the fit.
Linderbaum comes in here now for the New York Giants, gives them a massive bolster up front. We've already seen Dave Gettleman spend some picks on that offensive line, Matthew Peart, Andrew Thomas, a few others as well, Will Hernandez a few drafts ago as well. Tyler Linderbaum kind of comes in, supplants the middle, and fills in a big-time need for that New York Giants roster. I think that's going to be something that helps Daniel Jones identify pass protection. Tyler Linderbaum, a very smart center. And also going to help Saquon Barkley in the run game. I think that makes a lot of sense for the New York football Giants. Pick 11, we are looking at the Minnesota Vikings now. They've just had a disappointing start to the year. They're 1-3. I think their roster is a lot more talented than that 1-3 record really indicates. So I'm not sure if they'll stay up at this 11 spot all year long. I would expect them to get maybe closer to that 17-16 mark. But here at 11, Austin, who do you have Minnesota going with?
I think it's problematic that corner room, Breshad Breeland and Patrick Peterson have not been the guys that Minnesota thought they could be this season. Cam Dantzler has been up and down with his play. Mackenzie Alexander, the same thing. So this corner room's kind of in shambles as a whole. They have to once again look to that corner room. They got to make it right somehow, because they cannot continue to, you know, continue play with their current corner room. I'm going to have Ahmad Gardner go. He has not given up a touchdown, I believe, yet to this part of the season. He's an absolute stud in that secondary. Minnesota needs to make sure they have some back-end help. They might also look to address that second safety spot later on in the draft.
Right. Ahmad Gardner, one of the best players on that top five ranked Cincinnati Bearcat team. And he's a phenomenal piece that if the Minnesota Vikings were able to bring him in, could really, really bolster that defense as a whole. Of course, they got Harrison Smith extended. One comment we had on the last mock draft, Austin, was, do the Minnesota Vikings deserve the right to take another cornerback in the first round with some of their misses, with Trey Waynes, Jeff Gladney, Mike Hughes? Does Mike Zimmer, if he's still there, and Rick Spielman, do they have the opportunity to take another risk on a cornerback on draft night?
I think they have to. I don't think you can let, historically speaking, how they've drafted affect this draft. You have to really separate those drafts as a whole, because the issue is you're not going to solve it by not doing anything about it. And that's where that's going to come into play. Unless they want to do something in free agency, which they're going to be tied down with money that they don't have. So you have to address it in the draft. There's no other way of really going about it.
Right. And I think that's one of the key reasons that they've spent three first round picks in the last 7 years on that cornerback spot. They've been trying to find the solution. They haven't yet. Ahmad Gardner, though, I'm very optimistic that he would be that solution there in Minnesota. I think he's a phenomenal fit into that scheme. Pick 12 here, we have the Pittsburgh Steelers. Ben Roethlisberger looking like he's on his last legs at that quarterback position. Just been a disappointing start to the year again for Pittsburgh. They've got such a talented defense. The offense just isn't getting the job done, especially with some of Ben Roethlisberger's decision-making this year. It's been really the big question for me. it has to be quarterback here for Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah, it's absolutely going to be it's going to be a quarterback for Pittsburgh. Sam Howell is going to be the pick. Once again, he is falling a little bit on boards just because he's not played exactly how we thought he would. And this is a guy just a couple of weeks ago that people thought was either the number one or number two pick. This is great value for Pittsburgh, because if there's any quarterback, you know, destination that you really want to go, Pittsburgh is a great spot for you. You have plenty of weapons. You have Najee Harris, Deontay Johnson, you have Claypool and Juju. That's a good collection of weapons, and all they really need to do is see if they can develop Pat Freiermuth, because overall that's a very, very nice group of weapons.
Right, that defense is stacked. That offense has some really nice playmakers already in place. For Sam Howell, he comes in day one, has a nice cast and crew around him, and I think we could see Pittsburgh get back on track rather quickly with a Sam Howell selection. Pick 13 now, we have the Miami Dolphins here on the clock. This pick comes from the San Francisco 49ers, again, part of the shuffling that they did last offseason before the draft. Miami here has a few different needs. I think you could look at safety for them. I think linebacker could be a potential need as well. What did you really identify as a key positional area for the Miami Dolphins at this point?
I think it's key for them to build along that offensive line still. Really, if you believe Tua is the quarterback, you have to make sure you can keep him upright, keep him healthy, if that is the plan moving forward. Who knows? Maybe they'll pull a trade for Deshaun Watson and they might not even own this pick. However, we are assuming that they have this pick. We're going to have Kenyon Green go, a guy that offers some versatility. You can have him play tackle. He could be a really, really nice guard at the next level as well. Either way, you're getting a really good offensive lineman to slot into this Miami offense, and I think it's a crucial need for them.
Right, I think he can step in, protect Tua Tagovailoa. We saw him take a nasty shot a few weeks ago where basically an edge comes in unblocked. That's just not acceptable at the NFL level. You need to keep your quarterback upright, and bringing in a tackle like Kenyon Green out of Texas A&M could really help you do that. I don't think we're going to stray too far away here from Texas A&M either at this point, Austin, because we got the New York Jets here on the clock. This pick comes from Seattle in the Jamal Adams trade, and I think there's one player specifically that has slid a little bit further, maybe because of positional value and some of the key needs of some of these other teams. Is that player DeMarvin Leal here for the New York Jets?
He is going to be the pick for the New York Jets, reason being he offers so much versatility along that defensive line. He's played defensive tackle, he's played edge. There's so much you can do with him, and the New York Jets definitely need that versatility along that line. And if you look at what they've done so far in this draft, they add Stingley, and now they add DeMarvin Leal, potentially two top five players from this class, which is really, really impressive as a whole. So hopefully, you know, for the New York Jets, I don't think they're going to be picking around that 14 with their second pick, but this would be an absolute dream scenario for them if that happened.
The only one happier seeing this mock draft than Jets fans should be Robert Saleh, because these are two key build-around pieces for a defense. DeMarvin Leal, like you said, the versatility and the importance of the defensive line play in a system like Robert Saleh's is vital for any survival in the run game and also getting after the quarterback. DeMarvin Leal can bring both of those elements to a defense, and then you get that elite man-to-man guy in Derek Stingley, one of the best cornerback prospects we've seen in quite some time. That's a phenomenal 1-2 punch to land in one draft in the first round. If the Jets are able to make this happen on draft night, they would have to be one of the biggest winners immediately, just because of the level of talent that they've been able to acquire with their two picks up to this point. Pick 15, we have the New Orleans Saints here now on the clock. Austin, big question mark has been Jameis Winston pushing the ball downfield. He's not throwing for a lot of yards so far this season. And I think surprisingly, Sean Payton's offense seems a little limited with him at quarterback. Now, part of that comes from Sean Payton kind of dialing back play call, probably trying to limit turnovers. How can the New Orleans Saints go about improving this offense long term?
They have to get another wide receiver. We've seen this offense kind of struggle with Alvin Kamara being the only true playmaker on this team. But now you have to look at it. Michael Thomas will be back. And then you add a guy like Garrett Wilson, who also could be a nice red zone threat for this team. They have to get better outside, and it's not going to happen unless they address it early in the draft here. They don't have a lot of money to work with, so you can't sign anybody. So you have to address it here in the draft. Garrett Wilson would be a nice complement to Michael Thomas and Alvin Kamara, and that really gives Jameis Winston the best chance to succeed.
We see the Saints going back to that Ohio State draft pool. They've done it plenty of times. Marshawn Lattimore, Michael Thomas, two of the most recent examples. Garrett Wilson coming in here, pick 15. right around where his value should be on draft night. And he's a phenomenal piece to really help improve that passing game specifically with Jameis Winston. Pick 16, we have the New York Giants on the clock yet again. Remember, they went with Tyler Linderbaum, the center out of Iowa, with their first pick in this year's draft. And now at 16, this pick coming from the Chicago Bears trade up for Justin Fields. Where else are the Giants looking to improve this roster?
I think the New York Giants should look at the second level of their defense. There's one player that's played extremely, extremely well so far this season, and that is going to be N'Kobe Dean from Georgia. Georgia's defense has been absolutely lights out. They obliterated Arkansas, which people thought Arkansas might have had an okay chance of at least being close in this game. It wasn't. N'Kobe Dean is an absolute stud. Really, really great tackler, really good in open field to make those tackles. And that's what the New York Giants need as well. They have Blake Martinez. He is hurt. But I think adding a guy like N'Kobe Dean could go a long ways in helping improve that second level.
Right. We've seen them improve their secondary greatly over the last couple of years. James Bradbury, Adoree Jackson, two really good signings out in free agency. Now looking into that second level to kind of add a little bit more insurance against the run and maybe a little bit more athleticism and flexibility alongside Blake Martinez makes a lot of sense. N'Kobe Dean coming in out of Georgia. I like this a lot for Dave Gettleman and the New York Giants. Pick 17, we have the Kansas City Chiefs here. They got back on track with a big-time win. Tyreek Hill had a massive day. Fantasy owners, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And now at pick 17, Austin, I think it's clear that wide receiver 2 might still be a key need for this team. They're trying to fill it this year with Josh Gordon. What other positional areas did you consider, and did you end up opting for that wide receiver spot?
I actually didn't go with the wide receiver. I thought about that for sure, but I think there's another need that they do have to address. Once again, we are going back to the linebacker spot because you want to replace Anthony Hitchens long-term. Christian Harris is going to be the pick. Kansas City has struggled defensively so far this year. I think part of that is that linebacker unit. Specifically, a guy like Anthony Hitchens is not going to stay around likely forever. And I think they would be having a huge upgrade here by taking a guy like Christian Harris. Once again, very, very solid in a lot of areas of his game, especially tackling wise. He has been impressive. He's actually been a little somewhat underwhelming compared to where I thought he could be this year. However, I think, you know, as time goes on, a couple more games, he's going to be a big impact player, especially like once we get more towards the national championship time.
Defense is going to be vital for the Kansas City Chiefs to make phenomenal picks in the draft on, because with the amount of money they're spending on Patrick Mahomes, Orlando Brown, Travis Kelce, and Tyreek Hill is going to really hamstring their ability to keep key members on that defense. Finding guys in the draft who are going to be able to play on rookie contracts and also help you win games in the short term while also being nice upside players as well is going to be vital for the Kansas City Chiefs to maintain the level of success that I think we're all expecting and holding them to in terms of where we expect them to be in the NFL as one of the best teams in all of football. Pick 18, we have the Los Angeles Chargers here. Again, this is coming before their Monday night matchup with the Las Vegas Raiders. Justin Herbert's looked great all year. Mike Williams is an expiring contract at this point. We've talked about the edge positional need for them. Where do you really look here for the Los Angeles Chargers?
I'm going to stick at that edge spot. Just like you had mentioned, Aiden Hutchinson has been absolutely dominant this season. He is gaining the respect of a lot of his peers, and especially guys around the college football world. He currently has the highest pass rush win percentage rate of everybody in college football. He's taken some huge strides in terms of his pass rushing technique. Absolutely love him here at 18. He does slide a little bit, but he's getting a ton of traction in the draft community.
Right. We see the Chargers here coming with a second Big Ten member to put on their defensive front across from Joey Bosa. The two of those guys are going to wreak havoc in the AFC West if they end up on the same team. I think this is a very nice draft pick here for the Los Angeles Chargers and makes that defense for Brandon Staley extremely, extremely terrifying. Pick 19, we have the Tennessee Titans now on the clock. Of course, a disappointing loss to the New York Jets. They're still at 2-2, though. Could still run that division if they get back on track. Where do they really look? To me, it has to be offensive line in a lot of respects, because they gave up 7 sacks to the New York Jets. And when you have your best player being a running back, you want to help him try and find holes, find other avenues to, you know, really move the football down the field. Is there another key position other than offensive line that I did not mention?
I'm sticking with that offensive line. Like you mentioned, this is probably the most crucial need for this team. And Ikem Ekwonu is going to be the pick from North Carolina State, a guy that people might not really be familiar with, but he is an elite run blocker, one of the best in the country, has done very, very well so far this season. And adding him to this Tennessee Titans offense is terrifying, because if he ends up being the best run blocker in this class and you're putting him on Tennessee with Derrick Henry, that's a scary combination. They are going to be very, very tough to defend against the run.
Right, adding an elite run blocking tackle is going to be a terrifying proposition for every other team, especially in that AFC South. They're going to have to deal with not only taking down Derrick Henry, but also now struggling to get to Derrick Henry to start with. Also, I love this for their play action game as well. Bring in a big mauler, someone who's going to help establish the run and set up other aspects of your offense as well, moving down throughout a game script. Pick 20, we have the Washington football team here now on the clock. Quarterback, quarterback, quarterback. That's been our discussion around Washington. They finally get Curtis Samuel back. They've got a lot of nice players on this roster. Does the conversation start and stop at that quarterback position?
It is going to be a quarterback. Once again, hopefully they can trade up if they want to get one of the top tier guys. But Carson Strong is not a bad option at this point. He's got a really, really nice arm. He's very, very talented with his arm. Mobility is somewhat of a question. Also, some of his decision-making has been questionable, has been termed as a one-read guy. I don't know, you know, if that's going to change heading into the NFL level, but Washington definitely needs a guy that can push the ball down the field, and that's what Carson Strong gives you. Terry McLaurin has done so well with the collection of quarterbacks he's had. I can't imagine him with a guy that can actually push the ball down the field.
Right, that could be a scary dynamic duo for sure, making scary Terry even scarier down the road. I would love that for Washington. Carson Strong, I think, could be the answer at that quarterback spot. There's also some other guys out there as well. Maybe a guy like Desmond Ridder in the second round, possibly. I don't think we have him going in the first round in this mock, but he's been lighting things up for Cincinnati as well. Pick 21, we have the Buffalo Bills here now on the clock, Austin. They play the Kansas City Chiefs this next week on Sunday Night Football. Both of those teams are highly competitive. And I think that's really kind of what guides our picks in a lot of ways. Is Buffalo going to be looked at as the little brother to Kansas City until they consistently start beating the Chiefs, even though they have a better record right now? Does this pick help them try and find ways to beat Kansas City long term? And what is the pick here?
Well, this is an exact reflection of what they need to do to get deeper into the postseason. We are going to be looking in that cornerback room for said help. Trent McDuffie, despite his 5'10 frame, is an extremely good college cornerback so far. He's only allowed 15 yards thus far, which is absolutely insane for the number of games we played. I think Washington's played 5 games already. Trent McDuffie allowing 15 yards in those games. This guy is a very, very talented corner. Now with that frame, you have questions about his potential ability to play outside, but if you're looking just for a really good football player, that's what Buffalo is getting in that secondary.
Right, we see some of those physical traits maybe hold him back a little bit in terms of where his draft position is. Going at 21, with that statistic you brought up and actually his compact nature, his ability to actually go out and cover, also make plays in the run game, he's a very, very good football player. And I think Buffalo is getting a really nice piece for that defense. Sean McDermott's definitely going to love having Trent McDuffie on his roster. Pick 22, we have the Carolina Panthers. A loss this past week to the Dallas Cowboys, but Sam Darnold is looking like an absolute menace on the ground. Who would have thought he's leading the NFL in rushing touchdowns for all quarterbacks with 5 of them so far this year? And part of that, you know, of course, comes to the script and Matt Rhule and Joe Brady putting the Panthers in positions to be successful and allow Sam Darnold to take advantage of certain situations and matchups. For Carolina, how do you think they go about improving this team? I think offensive line still should be considered a big helping point.
Yeah, you definitely think about that offensive line, but also I think Carolina wants to get stronger defensively. Maybe they hold off on a guard until round 2, but I think, well, they actually don't have their second round pick this year. However, I think in the first round, they're going to consider a guy like Jordan Battle. You put him and Jeremy Chinn in that secondary together, this is already a very, very talented defense, but they could make a big improvement by adding a guy like Jordan Battle. Very good all-around game at that safety spot. He can cover. Another thing he can do is make open field tackles. I feel very comfortable with him out there. Carolina, they could be scary. They could be really, really scary, considering that the offense is starting to figure it out. And defensively, they have really, we've seen quite a bit of progression over the last 2 years.
I really love this selection actually here with Jordan Battle. This is actually one of my favorites of the first round so far, because to me, Jeremy Chinn is a really special player who is very good in a variety of roles. And having a guy like Jordan Battle behind him or with him in that secondary kind of emboldens him to go make more plays, allow him to be kind of more of a roamer, allow him to go do a lot of stuff that he's capable of doing, because you have a security blanket safety with him, Jordan Battle. You also have Jordan Battle who can go make some of the other plays around him. And I think the two of them could really work off of each other well. That could be scary hours there in Carolina, especially in that secondary with now CJ Henderson and JC Horn when he gets healthy. I like the direction of that young secondary moving forward. Pick 23, we have the Green Bay Packers now on the clock. Of course, Aaron Rodgers probably in his last year there, transitioning to the Jordan Love era is going to be the MO for the Green Bay Packers during draft week. What do you think the Packers need to do to get their organization moving in the right direction post Rodgers?
If Davante Adams is not there next year, it's going to be really tough for them to move the ball through the air, just considering the collection of wide receivers that they have. So I think they have to go back to the well there. They could get a really, really nice wide receiver here in Treylon Burks, 6'3" frame. He has the ability to take the top off the defense as well. There's been some inconsistencies at quarterback at Arkansas this year. Treylon Burks kind of hides that just with his ability to go up and get the football. Once again, a wide catch radius, him and Drake London, very, very impressive in that regard. But Green Bay has to look at wide receiver, especially if Devontae's gone, in addition to Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah, I don't think Marquez Valdes-Scantling, Alan Lazard, and Randall Cobb would get the job done next year if that's the 1-2-3 punch there at that wide receiver room. Treylon Burks comes in, would be the immediate best receiver if Davante Adams is no longer there. And I like this fit a lot into Green Bay's offense. You kind of get that stylistic receiver that fits what they're looking to do. Pick 24, now you have the Cincinnati Bengals here on the clock. They've been very good this year, surprisingly. 3-1, I don't think anyone expected them to play quite this well. Ja'Marr Chase is looking like one of the best rookie wide receivers we've seen in quite some time. Of course, Justin Jefferson, his former LSU teammate, was so phenomenal last year. And Ja'Marr Chase is keeping up on pace with him in a lot of those categories. Bengals are a really exciting football team. I like the direction that they're going in. How do they continue to improve their squad?
I definitely consider corner at this spot, but I think it's actually pretty critical that they get an offensive lineman who can pass protect. That's going to be Jackson Kirkland from Washington. He's taken a little dip. He had a rough game last time out. Play strength is definitely a question for me, for him. However, he's got some really, really good feet. You can trust him, hopefully, in pass protection long-term. He's just got to get a little bit stronger. But with his athleticism, he has the opportunity to become a really nice tackle for this team. Looks like Jackson Carman could be staying at that guard spot. You have Jonah Williams at tackle and then Kirkland as your other tackle.
Right. I think Kirkland coming into an NFL weight room could be good for his career. You had mentioned the question mark about his strength. That's something that is very common in the NBA, of course, that guys have to get stronger. Not as common, especially for offensive linemen coming into the NFL. But from a technique perspective and agility perspective, you like Kirkland a lot. And I think this makes a lot of sense for Cincinnati's style of play, especially along that offensive front. Pick 25 now, we have the Tampa Bay Buccaneers on the clock at this point. Again, a narrow win over the New England Patriots in Tom Brady's return to Foxborough. And Tampa, you and I were talking during the game that they could use a long-term running back answer, especially to help them out with the salary cap picture. They also could use some help along that offensive line. Where are you opting for Tampa Bay at this point of the draft?
I have them going with a running back. You did kind of allude to it there. Breece Hall is going to be the pick. There's been no running back that's clearly came out and dominated and has proven that they are the best back in the class, but Breece Hall has that ability to potentially become that. Just considering he breaks tackles like crazy. He had 26 broken tackles on his last 60 carries. Really impressive clip for a college running back. There's a lot to like about him. He can be that true lead back for Tampa.
Breece Hall is the first running back to go in the first round during this series so far since the start of the regular season. That shows you how constantly evolving this series is, based off of team needs as the season really plays out, based off of how these guys are performing in college. And like you said, Austin, Breece Hall comes in to Tampa, fills a need for that organization. And I think long-term could really help them keep some of their other key contributors by having that fifth-year option on a running back. Pick 26 now, we have the Detroit Lions on the clock again. This pick comes from the LA Rams, from the Jared Goff trade that we've talked about already in this video. With the Detroit Lions here at 26, Austin, we already figured out the quarterback situation with Malik Willis. We've been very consistent throughout the series so far that it has to be a wide receiver here at 26. Does that stay true here in this mock draft?
It is going to remain true. Chris Olave is still available. Love the value here at 26. Chris Olave could have been a potential top 15 pick. He's had some inconsistencies, especially with CJ Stroud so far this year. But Chris Olave can be a true deep threat for Malik Willis. And this offense is looking so much better just after this draft alone. There's so much to love about it. And I think that's the perfect fit for them.
Earlier on in the video, I talked about a nice trio there for the Detroit Lions. I had accidentally left out TJ Hockenson from a nice quartet. Now you have a nice quintet with Chris Olave coming in. That's a phenomenal collection of young pieces, with Malik Willis really leading the way, being the key guy in that grouping. I love this direction for Detroit. Of course, they still have a lot of work to do. An 0-14 doesn't just turn it around overnight with two picks in the first round, but it is the start of something nice there in Motor City. Pick 27, we got the Denver Broncos here. Teddy Bridgewater has led them to a 3-1 record up to this point. However, he's now injured. Drew Locke possibly playing quarterback for them this next week. Does that impact kind of your thoughts on Denver's situation with the quarterback need? Are you looking quarterback here, or do you think that possibly edge could be in the cards? Where are you really considering here for Vic Fangio's Denver Broncos?
Yeah, I definitely considered defensive line here for sure, but I think offensive line might actually be potentially the bigger need. Quarterback would be interesting. However, I don't feel very confident in the guys that are still left at this point. Darian Kinnard is going to be the pick. We'll be able to step in, probably play tackle immediately for them. And also, if need be, he can be a guard at the next level. For the Denver Broncos, you have to make sure you're protecting your quarterback up front. They're going to rely heavily on that run game too, because you do have Melvin Gordon. You have Javonte Williams, two-headed monster. They're really going to be exciting to see what they do if they keep Melvin Gordon around long-term. But for this team, don't love what's there at quarterback. Maybe they're a team to watch for a Deshaun Watson trade as well.
That is a great point there. Deshaun Watson, I think, is going to be a big shape part of this NFL draft season, because the team that gets him is going to send out a few first-round picks and really kind of shake up who's going where in the mock draft. So especially when we get towards the end of the season, we maybe have a better feel about who's heating up to Deshaun Watson, who's kind of pulling themselves out of the Deshaun Watson sweepstakes, and that will greatly impact how the actual draft goes. Now the final five picks here, we have the Cleveland Browns on the clock at this point. They are such a well-oiled machine there in Cleveland. Where do you think that they need to look to improve this football team yet?
I think Cleveland, just considering we don't know the status of Jadeveon Clowney, I think we're going to sound like a broken record when we talk about this, because it's that crucial. We've seen how successful Cleveland can be when they have another guy opposite of Myles Garrett. And I don't know salary cap wise if it's going to work out again where they can retain Clowney. So I think Kingsley Enagbare is going to be the pick from South Carolina. Good motor, a guy that you can definitely trust opposite of Myles Garrett. This defense is already really special. Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah was a pick last year that really surprised people that he fell that far. They've done a nice job as a whole with that back half of that secondary as well. Some of their guys that weren't initially playing were playing well or got hurt are now playing at a very, very good level. So Cleveland's defense is looking scary. Their offensive line is already really good. This team's one of the most talented rosters in the league for sure.
As one former South Carolina Gamecock probably finds his way out of Cleveland in Jadeveon Clowney at the end of the year, a new one comes into town in Kingsley Enagbare. Phenomenal value here at this point, finding an edge rusher across from Myles Garrett. You've talked at length about the importance of doing that and really opening up Myles Garrett as a pass rusher. This is a home run pick, in my opinion, for Cleveland. Pick 29, we have the Dallas Cowboys. They've had such a great start to the season. Trayvon Diggs has looked the part at that cornerback position. And it looks like they are righting a lot of the wrongs that they've had in recent years, especially with his play. Also, Dak Prescott's looked phenomenal coming back from injury. Where can Dallas look to improve? Do they still need another cornerback opposite of Trayvon Diggs?
It's going to be a theme. Andrew Booth Jr. from Clemson is going to be the pick. I think that's going to be very common in mock draft season, just considering that last year they opted to not go with a corner and they decided to go with the linebacker in Micah Parsons. And that has looked like a good pick. He is a very, very talented player. And it's really going to come down to salary cap restrictions. One of their key linebackers is going to be on his way out after the season's over via trade or a release. Andrew Booth Jr. is going to step in at that corner spot as the number two, and they're going to look a lot better in that secondary.
Right. Cowboys fans who watched us all last year throughout the mock process thought we thought cornerback was going to be the pick to put someone beside Trayvon Diggs long term. They didn't do it last year, but this year is something that they're going to for sure do, in my opinion. Anthony Booth Jr. makes all the sense in the world at 29th overall. Pick 30, now we have the Baltimore Ravens. They're a little bit up in smoke right now because of their decision to run the football while up by, I think, 17 points or so against Denver in order to keep their running game streak alive. Doesn't look good, in my opinion, on the organization to do that. However, that's in the past now. How can Baltimore look to continue to improve their team for the future, especially with all the injuries that they have at the current moment?
Yeah, I think offensive line is really key for them. Daniel Falele is another guy we're going to keep mocking in this first round until he proves us wrong. He's only allowed 3 hurries in the entire season. Really impressive film that we've seen from Falele, a guy that you had a few questions about as a pass blocker, just considering his size at 6'9", 400 pounds. But he's proven to be that really, really stout offensive lineman. Could be higher if he was a little more technically sound, a little more nimble, but nevertheless, he could make for an elite guard at the next level, but also could stick at that tackle spot.
Yeah, I think the upside here really comes with his ability to get out in the run game. That pure size, that mauling nature that he has that you've talked about a little bit on the channel, I think really molds in well to Baltimore, a team that's so committed to running the football. I think this is a match made in heaven between both Falele and the Baltimore Ravens. Pick 31, we have the Las Vegas Raiders. A really surprise season so far from them. They've looked absolutely phenomenal. At this point, there's a few areas where you can maybe look for some long-term improvement, especially getting some youth into certain positions. Where did you offer Las Vegas at pick 31 in this mock draft here?
Yeah, this one was a little tougher to mock, but I actually have them just going best player available right now. George Karlaftis is going to be the pick. Him and Max Crosby could be a very nice duo for a long time. Karlaftis, really good against the run, an improving pass rusher as well. This Raiders team is looking better and better by the week, and hopefully they can keep it going tonight against the Chargers, but Karlaftis fits into this culture very well.
Karlaftis comes in here from Purdue. I think this is a really nice grab. We know how key it is for Las Vegas to continue building up that defensive front. They brought in Yannick Ngakoue in free agency. They have a lot of talent there, and they're going to look to continue to add to it because it's a big part of how they like to defend on game day. I think George Karlaftis, a nice grab. Now bring us to the final pick here of the first round. If you guys have enjoyed, make sure to hit that like button. Comment your favorite team below as well. We'd love to hear from you guys. Who are you a fan of? And now, Austin, with the Arizona Cardinals, a team led by Kyler Murray, you had talked preseason about him possibly being an MVP candidate. He has looked the part. Where does Arizona need to continue to improve, though, as a football team holistically?
I think at that corner room, you can upgrade over Robert Alford. So you look in the corner room, it's a little thinner here, but a guy that has some upside, Roger McCreary, really smooth hips. He's already got 2 picks so far this season, really on top of his game. I love that for Arizona. And kind of looking through some of the grades, they didn't like the Willis pick because of their, quote, value, but we had some very, very good picks, especially that 3-6 range as well. They didn't love every single one of our picks, but however, this is a computer and they have it based off of their, their draft values. So overall, they say that Atlanta ends up winning the draft. Oh no, this is just overall grades if you were to have more.
Right. Yeah. So the one thing here with PFF grades, they have certain guys that they like. Remember earlier on in the process that you guys had been staring at Spencer Rattler as the number one guy while Austin was mocking him 12th. I'm sure in this mock you had noticed he got knocked down from that number one ranking. They're actually a few weeks behind where Austin is with his evaluation. And then so his picks are getting graded based off something that is actually lagging behind the actual norm and reality of college football season. and also the NFL as well. So there's a reason why we're seeing some real changes in these grades. I expect the Malik Willis grade to really pick up as the season goes on. Do not worry about the grades as much. They're just kind of fun visuals to see at the end of the video as well. Thanks again so much for watching, guys. Hopefully you did enjoy. Austin, thanks so much for putting together another great mock draft. It's awesome talking some NFL college football players with you, and we'll see you guys in the very next video.